Hello everybody, welcome to NEET Crash Course Biology. So today we will be discussing the synopsis of two major chapters. The first one is Molecular Basis of Inheritance. Now in this chapter, the major emphasis is on nucleic acids. As you all are aware, there are basically two types of nucleic acids, and basically nucleic acids are polymers of nucleotides. They are also called polynucleotide chains. The two major types of nucleic acids are deoxyribonucleic acid and ribonucleic acid. You know that DNA is the genetic material in most organisms, whereas RNA is mostly found as a genetic material in viruses and mostly in retroviruses. It was in 1953 that James Watson and Francis Crick, based on their X-ray diffraction studies, which was actually the X-ray diffraction studies were performed by two different scientists called Morris Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin. And based on this X-ray diffraction techniques, James Watson and Francis Crick proposed the very famous model for which they won a Nobel Prize. And this model was referred to as the DNA double helix model. You always have to remember the structure of the DNA double helix, and also it was Erwin Chargaff, who stated that the ratios of nitrogen bases are constant and always equal to 1. That is, A plus G in the numerator divided by C plus T is equal to 1. So what does this mean? This means the number of purines in the DNA molecule is always equal to the number of pyrimidines. Adenine and guanine, which are in the numerator, represent the purines, and cytosine and thymine represent the pyrimidines. So A plus G divided by C plus T is equal to 1, according to Erwin Chargaff. Now then came the search for the genetic material much before the DNA double helix model was discussed or was given by Watson and Crick. People did not know that DNA was the genetic material in most organisms. It was basically the pioneer work in the search for DNA as the genetic material came about by Frederick Griffith. And what Frederick Griffith did was, he performed a series of experiments on pneumonia-causing bacteria that is called Streptococcus pneumonia, and it causes pneumonia in mammals. Now, you all are aware that the Streptococcus pneumonia exists in two possible strains. Some of them have a capsule on the outside, a lipopolysaccharide capsule or glycocalyx on the outside. And therefore, when you grow these colonies in the lab on a petri dish, they produce smooth and shiny colonies. And such bacteria that produce smooth and shiny colonies because they have a capsule on them are referred to as the S strain or the smooth strain. All of you remember that it is the S strain or the smooth strain that is considered virulent, because this capsule, the outer coat, which is present on the bacteria, will help the bacteria evade the immune response of the host. It can hide from the immune response of the host, and therefore it can cause the disease. So virulent meaning it is capable of expressing the disease, which is pneumonia. The other strain that he worked on was the rough strain. In the rough strain, there was no capsule, and therefore it could be detected by the immune system very easily and destroyed, and it grew in the colonies to produce rough colonies. So basically we discussed about two colonies, that is two strains. One is rough strain, which does not cause the disease. Why the rough strain does not cause disease? Because it does not have a capsule on its outside. And when it does not have a capsule on its outside, it becomes recognized by the immune system and it is destroyed. So as a result, the mouse into which this rough strain is injected, it does not die, it lives. Whereas if you inject the smooth strain, which is the virulent strain which causes pneumonia, the mouse dies of pneumonia. And then he injected heat-killed smooth strain. The smooth strain, which is the virulent strain, was subjected to heat and it was destroyed. And then it was injected into the mouse. And surprisingly, the mouse lived, obviously to indicate the fact that even though you are injecting the smooth strain over here, what did you do to the smooth strain? You have killed it using heat. The last trial was something which was a path breaking because he introduced two of the strains together, live rough strain, which actually does not cause a disease, along with the heat killed smooth strain, which supposedly should not cause any disease, but surprisingly the mouse died. So what happened probably here, like I told you, live R strain was injected with heat killed smooth strain. So what must have probably happened? Now what this particular process that could have probably happened is some biomolecule from the live R strain would have been transferred into the heat killed S strain, and it would have some biomolecule from the heat killed. See, whenever you have killed the strain, it doesn't mean that every part of it is completely destroyed. So some biomolecule from the heat killed S strain must have migrated on to the live R strain, and it must have transformed the live R strain into live S strain by restoring in it the capacity. Some capacity it must have restored in it. Today we know that it must have restored the capacity of capsule formation. So even though you have killed this S strain, heat killed S strain, some biochemical component, which was later obviously identified to be the DNA. The DNA was identified to be the transforming principle. So some biochemical component from the heat killed S strain must have transformed the live, must have migrated, must have diffused into the live R strain, and it has transformed the live R strain into live S strain. And so this word is very, very important. What got transformed into what? The live R form got transformed into the live S form. Today we know that the biochemical component that was moved, that migrated, that was transferred from the heat killed S strain to the live R strain was the DNA. Surprising that you have killed the S strain using heat, but DNA, some part of the DNA happened to be stable. And then you know that because some cases the DNA has a higher melting temperature, it doesn't get destroyed even on subjecting it to heat. And that DNA must have migrated to the live R strain. It must have become incorporated with the live R strain, and it has transformed the live R strain into live S strain. Okay. So how did they identify that it was DNA, the transforming principle? They treated the colonies of live R strain with purified biochemical molecules of heat killed S strain, and they saw that only when they treated it with the DNA of the S strain, only then. So that means you have colonies of live R strain growing with you, and when you treat the live R strain only with the DNA sample of the S strain, isn't it? So only when you treat it with the DNA of the S strain, the live R strain is getting transformed into the live S strain. So it is only the DNA molecule of the S strain that has the ability to transform. See, this process is referred to as transform. So the ability to transform the live R strain to live S strain lies in the DNA of the S strain. This did not happen when you treated the live R colonies with the protein of S strain, or when you treated it with the RNA of the S strain, isn't it? So you extracted the RNA molecule of the S strain and you treated it with the colonies of live R strain. This transformation did not happen. So let me put a minus sign. Neither did it happen when you treated it with the carbohydrate of the S strain, when you treated the live R colonies. So it happened only when you treated the live R colonies with the DNA, purified DNA extracted from the S strain. And that clearly, unequivocally told us, or it declared to the scientific community, that only the DNA of the S strain is doing the job of this transformation. That means the DNA is the transforming principle. So this also, one more proof that DNA was the hereditary material, came about with the famous blending experiment. The blender's experiment was performed by Hershey and Chase using a virus that infects bacteria. The viruses that infect bacteria are referred to as the bacteriophages. What they did here is they took a bacteriophage, and in this bacteriophage what they did was they labeled the protein coat of the bacteriophage with sulfur molecule, that is S13 certified, and they labeled the DNA molecule of the bacteriophage with phosphorus, that is isotope 32. Why sulfur gets labeled, why the protein gets labeled with sulfur? Because we know that the protein is made up of amino acids. There are some amino acids which have sulfur in them. So the sulfur, radioactive sulfur, gets incorporated into the protein coat, and the radioactive DNA gets incorporated. The radioactive phosphorus gets incorporated into the DNA. So this kind of hybrid bacteriophages, hybrid in terms of radioactive molecule, was created, and these bacteriophages were allowed to infect separate bacterial cultures. And then they saw, only when you see here what happens, you're allowing the bacteriophage to infect the bacteria. See how the bacteriophage is sitting on the host bacterial cell and it is injecting its DNA molecule. After you allow it to infect the host cell, you are going to subject it to blending. Why should you blend it? When you blend it, what happens is you are gently blending it so that the viral particles get detached from the bacterial cell. What do we call these viral particles, which are now empty because they have sent their DNA inside, they have injected their DNA inside the bacterial cell. These viral particles are now called the ghosts. So you want to get rid of the ghost from the surface of the bacterial cell. That's why you subject it to blending and then you centrifuge it. When you centrifuge it, you will get two fractions in the test tube. If this is the test tube, there will be a fraction that solidifies at the base of the test tube, and there will be a liquid suspension above. So this is referred to as the pellet. So you get a pellet as well as something which is referred to as a supernatant after you subject this to centrifugation. Surprisingly, they saw those bacteriophage which were labeled with sulfur 35, those bacteriophage whose protein coat was labeled with sulfur 35, the supernatant showed radioactivity with sulfur 35, but the pellet did not show any radioactivity. But those bacteriophage which were labeled with P32 in their DNA material, surprisingly, the pellet was the one. If you take the pellet that was obtained by those bacteriophage in which that were bacteriophage which were allowed to infect the bacteria and whose DNA was radioactive, it was seen that the pellet was radioactive. That means the pellet which contains the bacterial cell has become the radioactive component. That means some radioactive part entered into the bacteria. Obviously, which was the radioactive part in this particular bacteria? The DNA. So the DNA of the phage has been injected into the bacteria, and that's why the bacteria has become radioactive. But in this case, the supernatant did not become radioactive. So only in the bacteriophages whose DNA was radioactively labeled, only in those samples, the pellet after centrifugation exhibited radioactivity. This clearly shows that the bacteriophage during infection, it is injecting its DNA into the host bacterium. Whereas if you took, like I mentioned, if you radioactively label the protein coat, what becomes radioactive after centrifugation? So after centrifugation, radioactivity is restricted to the suspension, the supernatant, not the pellet. That means the protein coat is in the supernatant. It has not entered the bacteriophage. But in the last case, I told you that the pellet became radioactive. That means when you labeled the DNA of the bacteriophage, the labeled DNA has made its way into the bacteria, and therefore the pellet has become radioactive. So that clearly shows that in this bacteriophage, DNA is the hereditary material. Okay? So the features of the Watson and Crick double helix model, you all know that it is the B form of DNA among the most common form of DNA that exists in our cells. In this B form of DNA, you all know that it has diameter of 20 angstroms. The DNA double helix model has a diameter of 20 angstroms. It has a complete turn. The turn, a complete turn is referred to as the pitch, isn't it? A pitch or a complete turn. The length is called as the pitch, or it is also called a gyre. It is 34 angstroms or 3.4 nanometer. And in one complete turn of the DNA double helix, there are 10 base pairs, and the distance between the adjacent base pairs is 3.4 angstroms, or it is represented here in nanometer, it is 0.34 nanometer. So one step, you can imagine the DNA double helix to be a spiral staircase. One step and the next step, that is one base pair and the next base pair, it measures about 0.34 nanometer or 3.4 angstroms. And in one complete turn, which is the length of 3.4 nanometer or 34 angstroms, which is referred to as the pitch. All of you must remember that in one complete pitch, you will have about 10 base pairs. How exactly is the DNA wrapped in the eukaryotic organism? Now, obviously, this nucleosome model is not seen in the case of prokaryote, but it is therefore prokaryotic DNA is considered to be naked DNA. But in eukaryotes, you can see how the DNA wraps around a set of 8 protein complexes, which constitutes the histone octamer. This core of histone octamer, you can see, and associated with the linker protein, that is H1, and see how the DNA coils around it and to give rise to a beaded appearance. So this is how the DNA is packaged in the case of a eukaryotic chromosome or a chromatin network. Replication. Now, Michelson and Stahl's experiment is the classical experiment that proves that when we talk about DNA replication, that initially there were a lot of theories that were put forth saying that whether replication is conservative, whether it is semi-conservative. But if you see the Michelson and Stahl's experiment using heavy isotope of nitrogen, obviously they did not use any radioactive isotopes here. It was mostly the heavy and the light isotopes that were employed. So here you can see the DNA was grown, the bacteria was grown on a heavy isotope DNA for several generations. So both the DNA strands have become heavy nitrogenous, have incorporated the heavy N15 isotope. And how do you know it is heavy? When you centrifuge such a DNA molecule, the band is formed at the base of the test tube. More heavier the molecule, it goes and settles towards the base of the test tube. Otherwise, it starts settling towards the mouth of the test tube. As you can see, the lighter it gets, it gets closer to the mouth of the test tube. They saw that when you cultured the bacteria for several generations in heavy isotope, and then you transfer it onto a culture containing lighter isotope and let it complete one cycle of division, a bacteria multiplies every 20 minutes. For every 20 minutes, in every 20 minutes, one bacteria becomes two. That means one molecule of DNA becomes two molecules of DNA. After one generation, this is one generation of DNA replication. When they subjected the DNA of the daughter bacteria, they saw surprisingly the DNA was neither heavy nor light. It had one strand heavy and one strand lighter. Remember, you are culturing the daughter bacteria in lighter, a nutrient medium containing lighter nitrogenous isotope. And then when you left it for another 20 minutes, totally accounting for 40 minutes, you allowed the DNA in the daughter cells to undergo a second round of DNA replication. That is, after the second generation of multiplication or binary fission, they saw that surprisingly a light band had appeared after density gradient centrifugation. That means two DNA molecules which were completely light. These results are in line with the fact that when the DNA replicates, during DNA replication, when the daughter DNA molecules are produced, one of the strands in the daughter DNA molecule are retained from the mother, that is called the parental or the template strand, and one of them is the duplicate or sorry, not the duplicate, it is the complementary or the daughter strand. So when we have a DNA molecule where one of the DNA strand is the older strand or the parental and one of them is newly synthesized, every time we have a hybrid molecule like this, we say that the DNA is semi-conservative in replication, because half of it is parental, it came from the earlier generation, or we can also call this as the mother strand, and the half of it was newly synthesized. So this can be referred to as the daughter strand. Okay. So mechanism of DNA replication, you can expect in the mechanism how the DNA opens up. You can see that it has opened up to form a fork. This is referred to as the replication fork. And one of the strand that is running in 3 prime to 5 prime direction, you can see how the DNA polymerase enzyme, which is DNA polymerase, which is sitting over here, which sits over here in the 3 prime end, and anyway the DNA polymerase exhibits 5 prime to 3 prime polymerase activity. And as a result, you can see that it elongates the strand continuously. So you have a strand which is continuously being replicated. So what do we call this strand which is continuously being replicated? We call this strand as the leading strand. Isn't it? So it is being continuously replicated. Now notice this strand which is running in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. In this, the DNA replication is happening. See here, the DNA replication is happening towards the replication fork. In the leading strand, the DNA replication is happening towards the replication fork. And then in the lagging strand, notice the DNA replication is happening away from the replication fork. But one thing you should remember here is, because it is running in the direction of the replication, as in the polymerase activity of the DNA polymerase, it has to be replicated in the opposite direction in 5 prime to 3 prime, but it does not happen continuously. It happens in small stretches of DNA, and these small stretches of DNA are referred to as the Okazaki fragments. Okay. RNA world, a single stranded RNA, 90% of the RNA, now these are some facts that you must remember, 90% of the RNA occurs in the cytoplasm and the remaining is present inside the nucleus. The RNA is very similar to DNA, because RNA is also a polynucleotide chain which is made up of ribonucleotide, but the only difference is the sugar is different. That is, it is a ribose sugar. The ribose sugar at its 2 prime carbon has a OH group below and a H group above, as opposed to a deoxyribose sugar. Even the nitrogen bases are different, right? In RNA, we have adenine, guanine, cytosine, and instead of thymine, we have uracil. We have genetic RNA, which is the genetic material in viruses. We have non-genetic RNA, which is not the genetic material, but it helps in the expression of the genetic information, like we have in eukaryotes, that is mRNA and prokaryotes, actually mRNA, tRNA and ribosomal RNA. Messenger RNA is very, very small in number. It constitutes only 5 to 10% of the total RNA count. It has a length of about 900 to 1200 nucleotides. Please remember, it is single-stranded. It also is very short-lived. It is only living for a few minutes to a few hours. Based on what information it has, it may be polycystronic. It may carry information for more than one polypeptide chain, or it may be monocystronic. It may carry information for a single polypeptide chain. A polycystronic mRNA, like I mentioned, is usually carrying information or exons for two or more polypeptide or protein chain. It is very, very common in the case of prokaryotes. And generally, an mRNA at its 5 prime end has a 5 prime cap region, which is a unique nucleotide called the 7-methylguanosine nucleotide. And then it has a leader sequence followed by the coding region, which is the The coding region is basically made up of it starts with the initiator codon and it ends with the terminator codon. The coding region is the exon or the sensible region of the mRNA, and then the mRNA ends with the poly A tail, which is at the 3 prime end of the mRNA. It is a repeated unit of adenine nucleotides. tRNA or soluble RNA is slightly like we saw mRNA accounts for only 5 to 10%, but tRNA constitutes for 15%. It has about 70 to 85 nucleotides. It may form temporary double-stranded regions because it has self-complementary bases, and it was the most famous model for tRNA is the clover leaf model of tRNA that was given by Robert Hawley. And transfer RNA is also called the adapter molecule or the soluble RNA. It is called adapter molecule because it reads the message on the mRNA and it carries the specific amino acid. It also has a DHU dihydrouridine. It has a unique nucleotide called dihydrouridine and T-size C, which is basically pseudouridine, thymidine, pseudouridine and cytidine arm, which helps in recognition of the ribosome, and DHU helps in binding with the amino acid activating enzyme, which is nothing but the enzyme which is involved in formation of amino acyl tRNA during protein synthesis. So here you can see how the tRNA has T-size C arm, a DHU arm. These are the loops, the T-size C and the DHU. This is the CCA3 prime end. The CCA3 prime end is where the amino acid binds to it. And then you have the variable loop. This is a very tiny loop you can see here. And this is the anticodon loop bearing a set of three nucleotides, which is referred to as the anticodon, which forms hydrogen bases, temporarily hydrogen bases, with the codon present on the mRNA. Then coming to the most abundant RNA that you see in the cell, the most abundant RNA that you see in the cell is nothing but the ribosomal RNA. Now this ribosomal RNA constitutes about 70 to 80% of the total RNA. There are different forms of ribosomal RNA found in eukaryotes and prokaryotes. Like in eukaryotes, you have 28S, 5.8S, 5S and 18S in the smaller subunit. In prokaryotes, the larger ribosomal subunit, which is the 50S, has 23S and 5S ribosomal RNA, and the smaller ribosomal subunit, which is the 30S ribosomal subunit, has a ribosomal RNA which is 16S. The 16S ribosomal RNA at its 3 prime end is what interacts with the 5 prime cap of the mRNA molecule during the initial stages of protein synthesis or translation. I hope you know that this 3 prime end of the 16S ribosomal RNA that is present in the 30S subunit of the prokaryotic ribosome is referred to as the Shine-Dalgarno sequence. So please go through and read up on the 16S ribosomal subunit, ribosomal RNA in the 30S ribosomal subunit of prokaryotes. We know that the gene is a cistron. It is a structural gene. A cistron is something which is having a sensible sequence which is capable of coding for a particular polypeptide chain. Then we are moving on to genetic code. How is the information in the DNA stored? The information in the DNA is stored in the form of a code. It is a code of nucleotides or a code of nitrogen bases. It is referred to as the genetic code. Now let us run through some of the features of genetic code. You know that the codons are triplet. The entire genetic code can be divided into units, imaginary units, without any boundaries between them, and each unit is a consecutive set of three nucleotides, and that constitutes a triplet. So genetic code is a triplet, and there are 64 different types of genetic codons, out of which 61 code for amino acid, and the three are the ones which are involved in stop codon, which are referred to as the nonsense codon because they do not specify any amino acid. Then moving on to genetic code being universal, it is seen in all living organisms. And codon is degenerate. When we say codon is degenerate, that means that each amino acid can be coded by more than one codon. But remember, a codon cannot code for more than one amino acid, but an amino acid can be encoded by more than one codon, and this is called the principle of degeneracy. And like I told you, codons are unambiguous in the statement that I told you. A codon cannot code for more than one amino acid. That means a codon is highly specific to a particular amino acid. And that suggests that a codon is very, very faithful to an amino acid. And that's why it is said to be what? It is said to be unambiguous. Whereas the second part, that is an amino acid, can be encoded by more than one codon, represents what is referred to as the degeneracy of the codon. And always the third one is different and it has no specificity bearing in codon, and that is why encoding for an amino acid. And this non-specific third nitrogen base is the wobble hypothesis. And then we have punctuation codons like initiation and termination codons. You have AUG and GUG in mitochondria. And you have terminator codons like UAA, UAG and UGA in the case of the terminator codons, which help in termination of protein synthesis. Codons are non-overlapping. They are read in discrete units of a set of three nitrogen bases without any getting carried forward to the next set of codon, and therefore we say it is non-overlapping. None of these, and most importantly, I told you that there are imaginary boundaries between the codon. And when I say that there are imaginary boundaries between the codon, you have to remember that the codon is, the code is comma-less. There is no comma, there is no gap between the codons, okay? And like I said, a particular codon can code for a particular amino acid, so it is unambiguous. They are collinear, they are arranged in a linear pattern on the mRNA so that the same linear sequence can be read by the tRNA with the help of the ribosome, and they have a copolarity. The codons extend from the 5' region on the mRNA to the 3' region on the mRNA. Now, transcription, the first step in which you are copying the genetic code, remember the message on the DNA is in the form of a code which cannot be understood by the cells. Protein synthetic machinery, so basically you have to remember that this code which is present in the form of codons, a series of codons which constitute the genetic code, must be copied onto an mRNA. Who is going to collect that message and show it to the people in the cytoplasm, the machinery in the cytoplasm, who can then understand the DNA language? So in transcription, what is happening is the DNA language is getting copied onto, it is being converted into the RNA language. So for that you have initiation by the sigma factor and an enzyme called RNA polymerase. It goes and binds to a specific part of the cistron, which is referred to as the promoter, and then you can see how the DNA opens up, and specifically the RNA is synthesized in 5' to 3' end, copying the 3' to the 5' end of the DNA, and this DNA strand that is getting copied, the red strand. So the red strand is running in 3' to 5' DNA, and this DNA which is getting copied is called the non-coding or the template DNA, whereas the other DNA that is not participating in transcription is called the coding or the complementary DNA strand. And see how the message from this non-coding DNA, that is the red DNA molecule, is getting copied onto the RNA molecule. And now see, the RNA molecule is set free when it reaches the terminator region of the DNA molecule, and that is usually brought about by the binding of a transcription factor called the rho factor, which helps in the detachment of the RNA polymerase. So basically what is happening, you are transcribing. Transcribe means you're copying the message on the DNA, but in a different language, that is RNA language, okay? Once the mRNA is synthesized, notice how the mRNA's 5' end is capped with a unique nucleotide called the 7-methylguanosine, and then you can see how there are non-coding regions in the mRNA which are useless, which are called introns, and there are certain special complexes called spliceosomes which come to the sites where introns are there, which remove these introns to form a continuous stretch of exons, and this is called splicing, post-transcriptional modification. And you can also see at the 3' end of the mRNA, a polyadenylate tail is added. In translation, the mRNA has moved into the cytoplasm and now it associates with the RNA, tRNA molecule. See how the tRNA molecule is carrying an amino acid, and the first codon on the mRNA, which is the initiator codon, is already there and it has associated with the smaller subunit. If you consider this to be a prokaryote, you can consider the smaller subunit to be the 30S. So this is the first tRNA which comes and occupies or forms a temporary hydrogen bond with the codon present in the on the mRNA, and then you can see how the larger subunit is coming and sitting, and then see how the tRNA occupies a site on the larger subunit of ribosome called the P site, and the A site is vacant. Now another tRNA is coming and sitting on the A site. The moment both the P and the A site are fully occupied, you can see how a peptide bond is formed between the carboxyl terminal of the amino acid of the P site and the amino terminal of the amino acid of the A site to form a peptide bond mediated by the 23S ribosomal RNA in the larger subunit, which is referred to as the peptidyl transferase, and this peptidyl transferase brings about the formation of the peptide bond. Meanwhile, the amino acid and the tRNA which was in the P site will now be shifted to the exit site. It goes away, and then again the A site is vacant, and the same thing repeats until we get a polypeptide chain, and this is the process of translation. We also have the gene expression model in prokaryotes, extensively studied in case of prokaryotes. We have the lac operon, how the gene is organized. You can see how a typical gene has a regulator, has a promoter, has an operator, and most importantly, you have to say that this part of the gene is called as the functional gene, whereas this part of the gene which actually codes for a polypeptide chain, which is ZYA, is called as the structural gene. So the functional gene and structural gene together make up a cistron, or basically a reading frame. You can see how in this condition the lac operon is switched on. The structure, the functional gene, that is regulator, is coding for an mRNA, is transcribed to form an mRNA called the repressor mRNA, which codes for a protein called repressor, which is basically the one which blocks the, which actually this repressor in this case is getting bound by lactose. In switched on condition, there is lactose available in the surrounding medium. The lactose will block the repressor. So normally the repressor goes and sits in the operator region, but now it is not able to sit in the operator region. So the RNA polymerase enzyme, which is binding to the promoter, is free to go ahead. It will go ahead and it will transcribe the Z, Y and A genes into the lac mRNA, which will get translated, and this lac mRNA, on being translated, will produce the respective enzymes. That is, Z will produce beta galactosidase, Y will produce permease, and A will produce transacetylase, and all these three enzymes are involved in the metabolism of lactose. So because lactose is present, all these three enzymes are getting synthesized, are getting translated. So we say it is in a switched on condition. Switched off condition, you have to remember, you are not giving lactose. So lactose is absent in the surrounding medium. When the lactose is absent, there is nobody to turn the repressor off. So the repressor is in its active state, and notice how the repressor is going and sitting in the operator region. Now whose path is being blocked? The RNA polymerase cannot go further because repressor is sitting in its way. If it cannot go further, then this transcription will not happen. Then the genes, that is Z, Y and A, the structural genes, will not get expressed, and that means the operon is in a switched off condition. In DNA fingerprinting, the last technique in this chapter that you should know, we are mostly concerned with certain sequences called repetitive sequences. Say for example, there is a sequence like TA, 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 and so on. Here it is repeated 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times. All of us have the same repetitive sequences on our DNA, but the number of time it repeats is different. For me, it may repeat 1000 times. For you, it may repeat 1500 times. No two individuals have the same number of repetitive sequences. They have the same repetitive sequence, but the number of repetitive sequences is different. So that is what is the fingerprint. It's called fingerprinting because it is highly specific. It has nothing to do with your fingerprint, but just like how your fingerprint is specific to you, this technique ensures that the distinction created is specific to the person, except if there is identical twins, they can have the same DNA fingerprint in that particular case. So human genome has highly variable regions called mini satellite, which is about 10 to 60 base pair long, which is repeated several times. Like I told you, these small sequences are repeated many, many times. It is not about the sequence, it is about how many times it is repeated. Such repetitive sequences which occur in variable number of repeats are called variable number of repetitive sequences or variable number of tandem repeats. Surprisingly, they do not code for any protein, but they show high degree of polymorphism. That means they occur in different number of repetitive sequences. Like I told you, I may have 1000 repeats, you may have 1001 repeats, the other person may have 1050 repeats, the other person may have 2000 repeats. So that's why we say it exhibits polymorphism. Variations arise due to inheritable mutations, and such variations which occur, which can be passed on to the next generation, is called DNA polymorphism. And this, based on these variable number of repetitive sequences, the DNA fingerprinting technique was developed by a scientist called Alec Jeffries in the year 1985. So what they do here is the double-stranded DNA is isolated by using specific protocol, and it is cleaved using REN, and then you will separate the cleaved fragments of double-stranded DNA using DNA gel electrophoresis, and after that you can convert them by denaturing the double-stranded DNA into single-stranded DNA. The single-stranded DNA using southern blotting technique is transferred onto a nitrocellulose sheet, and it is placed on top of a gel. And when you put it in a buffer, the buffer solution will pick up the single-stranded DNA and it will be passed on to the nitrocellulose gel. And this transfer from the gel to the nitrocellulose paper is referred to as the southern blotting technique. And then you will hybridize the single-stranded DNA on the nitrocellulose with the specific VNTR probe. Accordingly, whether the VNTR probe, the variable number of the tandem repeat, will have the number of repeats will be changed in the probe, isn't it? Only if the number of repeats are changed, it will go and bind to the specific single-stranded DNA fragment in your genome, and it will specify that, say for example, I have prepared a probe of 1000 repeats. If it goes and binds to a DNA in your genome sample, that means I know in your genome there is a DNA sequence which has 1000 repeats in it. So probes will go and bind to specific complementary single-stranded DNA. If a probe goes and binds to a DNA, that means they are identical. So if a probe having 1000 repeats goes and binds to a DNA, I know that the DNA in the sample has 1000 repeat in it. If a probe having 10,000 repeat goes and binds to a DNA, I know that it is a DNA sequence having 10,000 repeats in it. After the probes are bound, they are autoradiographed because the probes are radioactive, and then you get a banding pattern of wherever the probe went and bound to. So wherever the probe goes and binds, there you will have a variable number of random repeat, and that gives you the banding pattern that is called the fingerprint. And see how the fingerprints are analyzed. See here, they have given the alleles. The allele 1 in the paternal chromosome, say in the chromosome 7 of the father, and chromosome 7 of the the chromosome 7 of one person, the chromosome 7 of the other person. In chromosome 7, one member has 3 repeats and the other member of the chromosome has 4 repeats of VNTR, and here the person has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 11 repeats. Here he has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 repeats of variable number of tandem repeats. So different chromosomes have different sequences. Same sequences in different repeats. See, the color is the same. He also has the same sequence. He also has the same sequence. But the number of times they repeat is different. And when you identify these repeats and when you subject them to the gel electrophoresis, based on their length, based on the length of the repeat, you can see how the repeats are extracted on the gel electrophoresis. And then when you probe them, you will see which repeat which person has, and you will compare the two. It can be used to identify criminals, it can be used for paternity testing, it is used to determine the population and genetic diversities, it is also used in solving immigration problems and family relationships. Okay, so these are the applications of DNA fingerprinting. Now moving on to the next chapter, that is biotechnology principles and processes. What is biotechnology? It is a branch of science which deals with technological applications of living cells. Basically, in biotechnology, we are very, very selfish because we want products which are of human importance, which are of human use. So in order to obtain desirable bioproducts from living cells, you are going to carry out biotechnology, isn't it? The most important step in biotechnology, that is the focus of this chapter, is genetic engineering, where you manipulate, you play God, you play nature, you manipulate the genetic material and you alter the chemistry of the genetic material so that you can alter the product, the protein product that is obtained as a result. You can introduce these altered genetic material into specific host organisms and bring about changes in the phenotype of the host organism. And then another step in biotechnology is, like I said, ultimately you are modifying the genetic material in order to obtain a modified genetic product, which is the protein. So you have to ensure that the protein that you obtain should be in sterile conditions. You should grow whichever host. It may be a bacteria, it may be a plant cell, it may be an animal cell. You have to grow it in sterile conditions. And that desired microbe, if you grow them with the desired gene of yours inside it, it will give you the desired product. And then you can obtain that product and you can use it for the manufacturing of certain biotechnological products like antibiotics, vaccines and enzymes. Asexual reproduction allows reproduction, sexual reproduction allows reproduction, but you here, in case of biotechnology, you already have set your goal on a particular gene. You want only your gene to get multiplied. You don't want other unwanted genes to multiply. In asexual reproduction, everything gets multiplied. The whole genome, the whole genetic material gets duplicated. But here in genetic engineering, your eye is on one stretch of DNA, one specific gene. And you only want your desired gene to increase in number, and that is possible through this particular principle that is referred to as recombinant DNA technology. So that also is made possible. And when you make multiple copies, say for example you have gene A, if you make 1,000 copies of gene A inside a bacterial cell, aren't all the copies alike? And all the copies replicas of each other, then it is referred to as gene cloning. Isn't it? Cloning means to make multiple identical copies of a particular gene. Now you are not bothered about any other gene in the cell. You only want one particular gene of your desired or of your interest to be multiplied. And that's why we use that this concept of, or this principle of, biotechnology. Cloning, like I said, you have your eye set on a foreign DNA and you want to make multiple copies of that foreign DNA. So what you can do it is you can splice it with an origin of replication site wherever there is origin of replication. Because if you simply take a piece of DNA and put it inside a host cell, do you think it will multiply? No, it will get lost. It will get degraded because the host cell has its own defense machinery, defense mechanism, which is going to destroy the foreign DNA. So most cases, what we can do is you can fix the gene of your interest with a suitable origin of replication so that it will replicate, it will multiply, it will produce multiple identical copies, which is referred to as the clone. Okay? What are the different tools in recombinant DNA technology? First of all, you need a gene, desired gene. Now, for example, a company wants to manufacture insulin in their laboratory, then their desired gene would be the insulin gene. Whichever protein you want to obtain in the laboratory, that particular gene is the desired gene, and therefore you have to obtain that gene from the host cell. You need to obtain the insulin gene from the human cell, or you need to artificially synthesize the gene in the laboratory. If you want to isolate the gene from a living cell, then you need a certain enzyme called restriction endonuclease, which will cut the DNA of the host cell into bits and pieces from which you can isolate your desired gene. Not only is cutting the genomic DNA important, say I want a gene from a bacterial cell, I will extract all the DNA from the bacterial cell, I will cut it into bits and pieces by subjecting it to restriction endonuclease. But now I have a bunch of pieces of DNA, but I have to separate it using a gel electrophoresis on a negatively charged field, because DNA is negatively charged, and when you apply voltage to the gel, it will move towards the positive field or towards the positive terminal. So this separation of the DNA fragments after subjecting them to restriction endonuclease treatment is referred to as gel electrophoresis. So in agarose gel, we use agarose, which is extracted from the seaweeds. It is a DNA fragments will resolve, meaning the double-stranded DNA that you obtain by cutting the genomic DNA using restriction endonuclease can be separated based on their size to charge ratio on an agarose gel platform in an existing electric field with a positive and a negative terminal. You literally pass current through the gel field to the gel to create an electric field in which these DNA fragments will migrate. Once the fragments have migrated, you can visualize them using staining, using ethidium bromide, and also by exposure to UV light. Ethidium bromide is a dye which gets highlighted when you expose it to the UV light. You can see the banding, and once you know where your gene of interest lies, you can extract that DNA, that gene of interest, from the gel column by cutting a part of the gel, a bit of the gel, and that is referred to as elution. Okay, so enzymes. Now, restriction enzymes, the enzymes that cut the double-stranded DNA. Now, I told you that if you want your desired gene from a particular genome, you need to cut the genome into bits and pieces, and you need to extract your desired gene, and that is possible only when you use these molecular scissors called restriction enzymes. In the year 1963, they were discovered for the first time in E. coli, that is Escherichia coli, and names are given to them. For example, the first restriction endonuclease that was used was called HIND2, and till today about 900 restriction endonucleases have been isolated from 230 different strains of bacteria. It is surprising that bacteria have their own restriction endonucleases, so majority of them are extracted from bacteria. How do you name a restriction endonuclease? For example, if you see the name ECOR1, E stands for the generic name of this bacteria from which it was isolated, CO stands for the species name of the bacterium, R stands for the strain of the bacterium, and 1, the Roman numeral, stands for the order of isolation. The first one isolated was 1, isn't it? So the order of isolation is given in the form of a Roman numeral. And then you have RENs are classified into two types: exonucleases, if they cut the DNA from the free ends of the DNA molecule, or if they make in between cuts on the DNA molecule, they are referred to as endonucleases. How do they cut the DNA? As you can see here, they recognize specific sequences on the DNA, which is referred to as the palindromic sequence, which is reading the same in both forward and backward direction. You read it in 5' to 3' direction, it is GAATTC. You read it in the backward direction from the 5' to 3', it is again GAATTC. Such sequences which read the same in both forward and backward direction are referred to as the palindromic sequences. Okay, now see how a DNA restriction endonuclease cuts the palindromic sequence. It cuts on two different sites on the sugar phosphate backbone on the opposite strands between the same two nucleotides. Here also it is cutting between G and A. Here also it is cutting between G and A. You have to subject your DNA to which you want to attach the foreign DNA and the foreign DNA with the same restriction endonuclease so that the cuts are matching. Only if the cuts are matching can you link them using the DNA ligase. So you are cutting the host DNA or the vector DNA, which is mostly a plasmid, which acts as a vehicle to carry your foreign DNA, which allows the replication of the foreign or your desired DNA. You're cutting both of them. I'm repeating again, you are cutting the foreign DNA or the desired DNA that you want to clone, as well as the DNA of the cloning vector or the host DNA, using the same restriction endonuclease. Why do you use the same restriction endonuclease? That is because you want the cuts to be even, you want the cuts to join together easily when you treat them with DNA ligase. Okay. So they usually produce sticky ends where the unpaired bases are hanging out, and blunt ends where there are no unpaired bases. Mostly for the for the two pieces of the DNA to join together, it is better if they have sticky ends, and this basically is what allows the two ends to come together and form hydrogen bonds between them. And then we have enzymes which are called polymerases, which express, which replicate the foreign DNA inside the host cell. You want multiple copies of the foreign DNA, so you're going to replicate using DNA polymerases. And then you are going to, most importantly, how do you fix the foreign DNA with the host DNA? Obviously by using molecular glues, and these molecular glues are referred to as DNA ligases. The DNA ligases are also referred to as the molecular stitchers or the molecular glues. You are going to put together the foreign DNA, and like I told you, for the foreign DNA and the desired gene or the gene of interest, the foreign DNA itself is the desired gene, and the host DNA, say for example the DNA of the cloning vector, for you to put them together you need a enzyme called DNA ligase. Then where do you put them? You put them into there should be a plasmid, that is the vector which carries, you need to put it with the origin of replication. If you simply drop a piece of gene into a host cell like a bacteria, your piece of gene is gone. So you have to associate it, attach it with the origin of replication. And where is the origin of replication present? The origin of replication is present on another stretch of DNA, which constitutes the vector which carries your foreign DNA, which carries your desired DNA. It acts as a vehicle. And once you put them together, what do you get? You get a recombinant DNA. And remember, your carrier molecule or vector must also have a selectable marker, mostly in the form of antibiotic resistant genes. It will allow you to select which are all the cells or the host cells which have received this recombinant DNA, so you can identify transformants, and among those which have received the recombinant DNA, which of those actually have the recombinant DNA it attached to them, that is which of them are recombinants. So to distinguish or to ensure the transformants and recombinants, you need a selectable marker on your vector DNA. Cloning sites are those sites where you insert your foreign DNA onto your onto the vector DNA. Imagine the vector DNA is a plasmid, and wherever there is a cloning site, there will be a restriction site. You will use a specific restriction enzyme. You will cut the cloning site. You will treat the foreign DNA with the same restriction endonuclease. So both the foreign DNA and the cloning site have even cuts, and then you will merge them using DNA ligase. So basically, the cloning sites are located within the antibiotic resistant gene, so that if you insert the desired gene within the antibiotic resistant gene, then the plasmid will end up losing the activity of the antibiotic resistant gene. And when you place or when you transform a bacterial cell with such a plasmid, which is carrying a foreign DNA in the place of antibiotic resistant gene, then that bacterial host cell will not show antibiotic resistance. So those which do not show antibiotic resistance mean that they have the foreign DNA with the vector in them. Those which still show antibiotic resistance means they have the vector in them, but unfortunately they don't carry the foreign DNA in them. Okay. So vectors are bacteriophages or mostly a plasmid. Now in this chapter, you will be learning the plasmid, that is the cloning vector, which is PBR322. See how a plasmid is a circular, double-stranded, autonomously replicating, extra-chromosomal, double-stranded DNA molecule, which is found in the cytoplasm, naturally occurring in the bacterial cell. But you can synthesize, like how the plasmid of Bolivar and Rodrigue were the ones which were actually synthesized in the lab by adding several sequences to them. Where will you put your desired gene here? Wherever you can see the restriction sites, these are called the cloning sites. Here you can cut the DNA of the plasmid using the specific restriction endonuclease, and you can insert the DNA of your interest. Notice that much of the sites are located in antibiotic resistant site. Now, for example, if I cut the DNA here in the BAMH1 site, and if I insert my foreign DNA, my gene of interest over here, then don't you think that this particular tetracycline resistance, which is exhibited by that sequence, is lost, because I am disrupting the tetracycline resistant sequence by introducing my desired gene in that. When I disrupt the tetracycline resistant sequence, the plasmid or the bacteria will no longer have any tetracycline resistance in it. Okay, and then you can see replication of the plasmid sequence, which codes for enzymes required for replication, and ORI site where the DNA replication happens. Like I told you, if you simply drop your foreign DNA into the host cell, it will not replicate, but now you have an origin of replication. It will multiply, and you will get multiple copies of your desired gene, which I've highlighted it, which I've shaded here, and that means you are achieving gene cloning. Okay. In animals and plants, we use different vectors to introduce the foreign DNA into the plasmid. Like for example, in plants, there is a vector, there is a pathogen which has its plasmid of its own, which is called the TI plasmid or the tumor inducing plasmid. If you introduce your foreign gene into the TI plasmid, it can deliver your foreign gene directly into the normal plant cells. Otherwise, you can remove these cancerous cells inside the TI plasmid so that to make it non-cancerous, and you can insert your desired DNA. And therefore, we can say that Agrobacterium tumefaciens is the nature's own genetic engineer, because normally also it has a plasmid which transfers its gene to a host cell or a host plant cell genome and converts it into a tumor cell. But now you're removing the tumor genes and you're introducing your foreign gene of interest. In plant cloning vector, just now I talked about Agrobacterium tumefaciens. In animal cloning vectors, we'll come to the cloning vectors in animals later. But like we said, in animal cloning vectors also, you have mostly either it is introduced directly into the genomic DNA within the nucleus of the cell, or you can use certain plasmids here also in this case. Okay. Now, once you have prepared a recombinant DNA, you have put your foreign DNA in the plasmid. Now, you need a cell for it to divide. You can't simply let it divide in a test tube. You can do that, but it is not sustainable. You have to drop your plasmid, which contains the foreign DNA, into a suitable host. For that, you have to make the host competent. The host has to welcome the recombinant DNA, and for that, you need to make it competent. That is done by treating it with calcium chloride, that is a divalent cation, by placing the host cell on ice and then suddenly raising the temperature to 42 degrees and again placing it back in ice. You are providing heat shock so that the cell wall develops tiny pores on it, which can take up the vector DNA along with the foreign DNA which is present on it. If you want to introduce it into an animal cell, you introduce the foreign DNA using microinjection, directly inject the DNA into the nucleus of the host cell and it gets incorporated into the nucleus cell. In some cases, if you want to introduce the foreign DNA or the desired DNA into a plant cell, you can basically use the biolistics or the gene gun method, in which you basically introduce, or you can say precipitate, your gene of interest on, I mean the plasmid along with the gene of interest on gold or tungsten coated DNA. So here tungsten coated particle, and then you bombard this gold or tungsten coated with DNA into the plant cell, and the DNA which is present on the gold and the tungsten particle gets incorporated into the genome of the plant. So basically what you're doing here is you have prepared the vector along with the gene of interest. Now you are transferring it into a host cell, a living system, so that it can multiply, so that it can express the gene of interest, meaning it can produce protein. Clear? And ultimately, when you get the protein product, it should not be on a smaller range, it should be on a very, very bigger range, and therefore you use these bioreactors. Bioreactors which usually can hold 100 to 1000 liters of culture medium. Imagine you're growing millions of bacteria in these huge tanks, and those bacterial cells or those plant cells or those animal cells carry your desired DNA in them, and they are expressing your desired protein, which is now called a recombinant protein. So to obtain the recombinant protein, you are going to grow these bacteria or plant or animal cell in a huge vessel called a bioreactor. There are stirring type bioreactors where you stir them continuously to ensure that oxygen is supplied to all the cells which are present in the nutrient medium, like bacterial cells, plant cells or animal cells. In an agitator system, an oxygen delivery system is there, where an oxygen is sparged into the system, into the liquid, and the oxygen dissolves so that the cells which are growing in the bioreactor medium require maximum oxygen in order to carry out their metabolic activities. I told you, rather than growing the cells in small petri dishes in lab and getting very, very small number of amount of gene product, you can grow them in huge vessels which have a capacity of 100 to 1000 liters to obtain the gene product. See how you have the stirred tank and you have the sparged tank bioreactor. One of the best advantages of bioreactor is you can maintain the pressure, you can maintain acid base pH control, you can maintain the steam inlet and outlet, you can maintain the pressure inside. By if there's too much pressure, then you can allow some steam to come off. You can prevent formation of foam. You can also keep stirring the culture medium so that the cells are given with enough oxygen. So we had learned the steps involved in recombinant DNA technology. Let us summarize it. You isolated the DNA, you cut the DNA, you inserted it. Now, mostly what they do is, I told you, you insert it into a plasmid or a vector into the host cell and allow it to multiply. Now they have devised an easy method to multiply a gene without a vector. This is called gene amplification by polymerase chain reaction. And then we saw, after you have obtained multiple copies, you have found a suitable vector to attach your gene with. You will introduce that recombinant DNA into a suitable host cell, which will start producing the protein. And I told you, once you have the host cell with the foreign DNA or a recombinant molecule in it, it is best to grow them not in small petri dishes but in huge vessels called bioreactors, and then extracting the product, purifying the sample, conducting clinical trials and ensuring that it is safe before commercializing it is called as the downstream processing. So like we said, if you want to isolate the DNA from a bacterial cell, you have to degrade the cell wall of the bacteria by treating it with cellulase. In bacteria, you use enzymes that degrade peptidoglycan, which is the component of the cell wall. But in plants, if you want to break the cell wall, you use an enzyme called cellulase. So peptidoglycan breaking enzyme is called the lysozyme, which ruptures the peptidoglycan layer and it punctures the bacterial cell so that the DNA is released into the outside suspension. If you want to extract DNA from a fungal cell, then you will use a fungal cellulose, which is referred to as the chitinase, because you know that fungal cell walls are made up of fungal cellulose or chitin. And then finally, when you obtain the DNA, when you add chilled ethanol from the sides of the test tube, you can see a cottony mass that precipitates, which is nothing but the DNA. From all this DNA, how will you extract your desired gene? Like we saw, you cut the DNA into fragments using restriction endonucleases, and then you subject it to gel electrophoresis, and then you subject it to southern blotting. You carry the piece of DNA onto nitrocellulose paper. You find out a probe based on your desired gene, and you find out which fragment on the gel column has your desired gene. Isolate the gene product, that gene, using elution method, as we had already discussed. So see, you are taking the foreign DNA, you're taking the vector DNA, which has to carry the foreign DNA. Simply, you cannot drop the foreign DNA into the cytoplasm. It will get lost. It will not multiply. Vector has tools to recognize the recombinant DNA, that is, such as selectable markers like antibiotic resistance. It has tools to allow the replication of foreign DNA, that is, like oocyte. It has tools which allows insertion of the foreign DNA, such as the multiple cloning sites we saw in ampicillin and tetracycline resistant regions in case of PBR322. Correct? See, you have cleaved, you have cut the foreign DNA, the desired DNA, as well as the vector, using the same restriction endonuclease such that the cuts are even. And then you obtain the recombinant DNA molecule by splicing them together using DNA ligase, and then you transform, means you introduce the recombinant DNA into a suitable host cell. And within certain cycles, the host cell, if everything goes smooth, the host cell will start expressing that foreign DNA in order to obtain a foreign product. How do you carry out cloning outside the bacterial cell? Now, the cloning within the vector with oocyte and all happens inside the host cell, but there is cloning that can be done in the laboratory also. It is called in vitro gene amplification, because here you are not multiplying the cell inside the host cell, but you're not multiplying the gene inside the host cell. You're obtaining multiple copies of the gene outside the host cell. So it is called the gene amplification of PCR. You take your desired gene, you denature it by subjecting it to 94 to 95 degree, and you anneal the polymerase and the primers and the polymerase at the 3' end of the single stranded DNA using a very specific temperature of 50 to 55 degrees centigrade. If you bring down the temperature to it, see, the 3' ends of the separated single stranded DNA will get coupled with the single stranded DNA, which are called primers, which are involved in replication of those respective template strands. After that, the primers must be treated with, they need to be elongated, so they need to be treated with a special enzyme called TAC polymerase, extracted from a thermophile called Thermus aquaticus, which needs a very high temperature of about 72 degrees in order to extend. That is, extension as in the 3' end of the primer will be extended by the TAC polymerase in the third step, which is referred to as extension. And notice how once the TAC polymerase extends the primer and synthesizes the complementary strand, we now have with us two DNA molecules. So we started with one DNA molecule, but we now have two DNA molecules. If you repeat this cycle for 30 times, you will get about 1 billion copies of the DNA. You started off with one copy of DNA, now you end up with 1 billion copies. And then you introduce it into the host. We've discussed all this. You make the host competent. If it is plant cell, you use biolistics or gene gun. If it's an animal cell, you use microinjection. And then we saw how you obtain the target protein by culturing the transformed cell, the cell that has received your recombinant DNA. It will that particular cell will start expressing the protein that is present on, expressed by the recombinant DNA, the foreign DNA that is present. Such a protein, now for example, for insulin, you are producing insulin protein in a bacterial cell because you're cloning in a bacterial cell, but you are producing a human protein. This is called, such a host, that is bacterial cell, is called a heterologous host. And this protein, it's actually a human protein, insulin. But surprisingly, it is being made in a bacteria. It's called a recombinant protein. Downstream processing is the last step in which you make sure that, like I said, the protein that is extracted, that is the desired gene product of the protein, it should be subjected to repeated testing and it should be subjected to clinical trials. Quality control must be carried out before commercializing it in the whole world. So this marks the end of the two major synopses, that is molecular basis of inheritance and biotechnology principles and processes. Thank you.